Okay, inshallah, we'll start the session now.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إذا السماء انشقت وأذنت لربها وحقت وإذا الأرض مدت وألقت ما فيها وتخلت وأذنت لربها وحقت يا أيها الإنسان إنك كادح إلى ربك كدحا فملاقيه فأما من أوتي كتابه بيمينه فسوف يحاسب حسابا يسيرا وينقلب إلى أهله مسرورا وأما من أوتي كتابه وراء ظهره فسوف يدعو ثبورا ويصلى سعيرا إنه كان في أهله مسرورا إنه ظن أن لن يحور بلى إن ربه كان به بصيرا فلا أقسم بالشفق والليل وما وسق والقمر إذا اتسق لتركبن طبقا عن طبق فما لهم لا يؤمنون وإذا قرئ عليهم القرآن لا يسجدون بل الذين كفروا يكذبون والله أعلم بما يوعون فبشرهم بعذاب أليم إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات لهم أجر غير ممنون
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم على نبينا محمد سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم ربنا زدنا علما رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا آمين أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته I would like to welcome our speaker, Ustazah Farhad and Sister Amina, and all participants to our weekly Tarbiyah session today. Alhamdulillah, all praise is due to Allah for all the blessings that He has given us. And today, Alhamdulillah, He has given us another opportunity to seek beneficial knowledge as part of our quest to become a better servant to Him. This program is conducted in collaboration with Aris University. Aris University has been running for 15 years doing structured Islamic studies courses, both on-site and online, and operates in 4 countries worldwide. Having hundreds of alumni doing meaningful da'wah across the globe, we also have Quran, Arabic, personal development and leadership programs. There are new courses offered by Aris. Inshallah, we will share the details with you at the end of the program today, so please stay tuned. Participants are encouraged to follow us on social media to get the latest updates on our programs. You can follow us on aris.edu on Facebook or aris_Malaysia on Instagram. Inshallah, today we will continue our session with the tafsir of surah number 84, Surah Al-Inshiqaq, followed by the youth session with the topic Khalid Al-Walid by Sister Amina. And if the time permits, we will do the Q&A. At the very end, we will do some announcement from Aris, and there will be a special announcement by Ustaz Farhad, inshallah. Without further ado, I pass on the session to Ustaz Farhad to proceed with our lesson today. Over to you, Ustaz.
Nahmaduhu wa nusalli ala rasulihil kareem amma ba'd. Fa'audhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Rabbish rahli sadri wa yassir li amri wahlul uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. My beloved sisters in Islam, I welcome you with the greetings of peace and mercy. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May the peace, mercy and the choicest blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on you. I hope and I pray you're in the best of health and in the best of iman, rising iman each passing day, inshallah. And today we are, inshallah, we are going to understand, we are going to try to understand and put it into practice also, Surah Inshiqaq. Surah Inshiqaq is the 84th chapter of the glorious Quran. And before we go ahead with the detailed explanation, I will first read the entire meaning so that we get a complete overview of the complete surah, inshallah. Before we do that, sisters, I'd request you all and myself as well to purify our intentions. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept this effort of ours. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open our hearts and our minds. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help us to imbibe, to understand the truth, to put it into practice, to pass it on to the others, and to keep striving to attain more and more of knowledge, inshallah. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. When the heaven is split asunder, when the sky is split asunder and listens to and obeys its Lord, and it must do so. And when the earth is stretched forth and has cast out all what was inside it and has become empty, and listens to it and obeys its Lord, and it must do so. O man, verily you are returning towards your Lord with your deeds and actions, and a sure returning, and you will meet him. Then, as for those who will be given his record in the right hand, then as for him who will be given the record in his right hand, he surely will receive an easy reckoning and will return to his family enjoying, masroor. But whosoever is given his record behind his back, he will invoke, he will call for destruction, and he shall enter into a blazing fire and be made to taste its burning. Verily, he was among his people enjoying. Verily, he thought that he would never return. Yes, verily, his Lord has been watching him. But no, I swear by Ash-Shafaq, and the night what is Wasaq, and the moon when it is Ittasaq, you shall certainly travel from one stage to another stage. What is the matter with them that they believe not? And when the Quran is recited to them, they fall not in prostration. Nay, those who disbelieve deny, and Allah knows best what they gather. So announce to them a painful torment. Except to those who believe and work righteousness and deeds for them is a reward that will never fail. Sadaqallahul Azim. Now, Surah Inshiqaq, sisters, it means the rending asunder. It means the splitting asunder, the breaking, the dividing, the ripping apart of the sky. And of sky meaning anything and everything that is within the sky. The stars, the planet, the other celestial bodies, all that. Because sky includes everything, not just the sky that we can see. It includes everything. So it's the tearing apart, the shredding apart, or you can say it's the slashing and slashing open of the sky. So basically the theme of Surah Inshiqaq is about the day of judgment, the good and the evil consequences, which is inevitable. So basically scholars have said that the theme of this surah is the inevitability, the conclusion of everything, all the creation coming to an end, the inevitability. Now, for the purpose of understanding, they have divided the surahs into four different parts. The part one is from verses 1 to 5, which speaks of the great change that will occur on the doomsday. Everything will change its state, how it is today and how it will be on the day of judgment. The second is from verse 6 to verse number 15, which speaks about the journey of the human in this world as well as the next. And man proceeding to the divine court, how it's going to be on the day of judgment and how the divine court will be. He being handed over his record of deeds, and his results are going to be evident. Then from verses 16 to 19 speak of the gradual changes in the nature, how nature is constantly changing, human being is constantly changing from one stage to the other, and will reach death and after that be born again, resurrected again, accountable in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So until he meets Allah. And then verses 20 to 25 speak of the warning of those who are obstinate, of those who are rebellious, of those who are disobedient, those who disobey Allah. After hearing the glorious Quran and after that glad tidings are given to the believers, that is those who obey. So basically this surah speaks about resurrection. And all human beings are divided into two categories. One is those whose record will be given in the right hand. They'll be forgiven. There will be no severe reckoning for them, no questioning for them, and they will enter into Jannah. And second category is that of the heedless, that of the hypocrites, and that of the disbelievers. So it includes all these people who will be given the record behind their back. And they will call for death, but they will never die. So that is an entire overview of the surah. Now let us see verse by verse what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to tell us, inshallah. So the first verse begins with when the sky is rent asunder, is a sama un shaqqat. That is, when the sky is split asunder, when it is torn apart, you know, the earth and the sky and all the different creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are the creation that are very, very obedient to Allah. And they are in constant tasbih of Allah. And they are waiting. The moment Allah commands, they're just going to obey what Allah says. So it's like izas sama. What is izas? Scholars have said there are two meanings of this. Mufassirin have said. And one is the basic meaning of Izn is permission, right? And the other is uzunun, which means to listen, to hear carefully from the ear. That means the part of the body which is the ear, which is used for listening. So listening carefully. So is a samaun shakkat, that is when the sky is just going to rent asunder. And this renting asunder, this splitting asunder, cutting apart, ripping apart, is going to be permanent. It is not going to then come back to its normal stage. That's going to be a permanent thing that's going to happen. Same thing with the earth. And in the second verse, Allah says, and obeys to its Lord, and it must do so, and it needs to do so. That is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it must obey. وَأَزِنَتْ لِرَبِّهَا وَحُقَّتْ. So this is the right of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator who has created, it is his right that the creation must listen to him. It's the obligation that we have to listen to him. But better than us are the earth and the sky. They are just waiting to submit to Allah. They are in a state of submission and they are waiting to split asunder when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands them. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them that commandment, they're just going to tear apart. Wa izal ardu muddat. And when the earth is going to be flattened, when the earth is going to be stretched, the sky and the earth are obedient beings. So it's like a point of reflection for us. What about man? What about man who's a sinner? Muddat is something, you know, flattened and stretched. The ability of stretching. And to explain this, scholars have given the explanation. You know how when you are stretching a sheet, when there are various, ups and downs on the bed, and you want to stretch it to make it a plain thing, how you stretch the sheet and you tuck it in. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to stretch it out. That means what all the mountains and the oceans and the rivers, whatever is there today, we see it in different forms, right? The shape of the earth, how it is, it's not straight and flattened. But on the day of judgment, everything is going to be flattened. Why? Because there has to be space right from Adam alayhi salam until the day of Qiyamah. How many people are going to be there? All of them have to stand on their 2 feet. Each one is going to get only the spacing of 2 feet to stand for the reckoning. And everyone is going to be there on that day, on the final day, on the day of judgment. So one can imagine how much space would be required, because how many people have gone behind before us? How many people are already dead in the ocean, in the earth? How many have been buried? All that. Subhanallah. You know, the heavens today we see as so high, so sacred, seemingly so vast and limitless, eternal and timeless. They remain just as long as Allah wills it. And not a moment longer than that. Similarly, the earth, we see the earth so strong, right? A whole globe enclosing whatever is inside it, all the secrets and the mysteries, the gold, the diamonds, the mines inside, the heat, the magnetic forces, the entrails, the innumerable bodies, the countless generations of men and women buried inside its soil, all that, everything it's going to throw out. And each one of us is going to stand on our 2 feet. Subhanallah. Something so solid and real we see today, it's going to become something which is perishable. It's going to dissolve. Everything is going to come to a different reality, a true reality on that day. So, wa izal ardu muttat. You know, here Allah is giving us the example of the sky and the earth for us human beings to compare it to ourselves. You see the earth and the sky, how they are just waiting on the verge to obey Allah. And what about us? Then Allah says, وَأَلْقَتْ مَا فِيهَا وَتَخَلَّتْ, and cast forth whatever is within, it will throw out and it will become empty. And وَأَزِنَتْ لِرَبِّهَا وَحُقَّتْ, its duty is of the earth to throw out. Now see sisters, all the creation, سَبَّحَ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, whatever is the creation of the heavens and the earth and all the other creations of Allah are in a state of obedience. The free will is given only to whom? To mankind. And these creations of Allah, they do not like it if we disobey. You know, it's as if the earth and the sky want to just rent asunder when there's something wrong that is happening. Like Allah mentions, you know, when the disbelievers, when they invoke a son to Allah, you know, in Suratul Maryam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, taqadu samawatu yatafattarna minhu wa tanashaqqal ardu wa takhirru jibalu hadda an dawlur rahmanu walada wa ma yanbaghi lir rahman an yattakhidha walada. That it is as if indeed that they invoke a thing so monstrous to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is as if the skies are ready to burst asunder. The earth is ready to split asunder. The mountains to fall down to utter ruin. That they invoke a son to Allah most gracious. Similarly, you know, all the creations, like we know how the fishes in the water, the birds in the sky, they are in a constant state of praise, of tasbih. When these creations are also like, they are so disturbed when there's something wrong which we as human beings do. And this is really such a clear depiction how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has shown this dramatic, you know, thing, how it's going to happen on the day of judgment and how these people are, like for example, you know, a teacher tells a student to do something, or maybe a teacher gives an assignment to one student, that student is not so happy to do it. Okay, so that is one type of student. There's another student who does it okay, you know, but there's another third student who's constantly waiting for that assignment. Teacher, please, you told me you're going to give me an extra credit, extra appointment, extra assignment. Teacher, please. That student is always asking. So now when the teacher gives the student, the third student is so keen, you know, to implement. How the third student is so keen to implement, just waiting, you know, to implement. Similarly, the creation, the sky is just waiting, so keen, will just immediately split asunder. The moment Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands, it's going to split asunder. And it is going to be such a heavy day for us. It's going to be such a day of turmoil. It's going to be such a day of, you know, extreme selfishness. Everybody is just going to be so worried about nafsi, nafsi. وَأَزِنَتْ لِرَبِّهَا وَحُقَّتْ, that is, and listen to its Lord, and it must do so, because that is what it is expected to do. So the sky and the earth are very keen to obey. So from verse number 1 to verse number 5, we see an entire description of how the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is waiting for the commandment for what it has been created. And as if its objective is only going to be achieved after it is going to split itself asunder and to the extent of its own extinction. After that, what is going to happen? It's going to come to an end. But yet, the sky wants to obey. The earth wants to obey. Then Allah says in verse number 6, Ya ayyuhal insanu innaka kadihun ila rabbika kadhan famulaqihi. That is, O man, verily, you are ever toiling on towards thy Lord. Painfully toiling. But you shall meet him. So here, what is this toiling? What is this constant striving? Oh man, you are going to meet your Lord. You're constantly toiling, constantly struggling. Like in another place, like Allah says, you know, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي قَبَدْ. That man is created in toil. Man is created in constantly struggle. You know, life is a constant struggle, whether it is for halal means or haram means, whether it is for anything whatsoever, but it's a constant hardship. It's a struggle. It's a hardship for everyone until you reach the destination and until you meet your Lord. You know, hardship, sometimes it may be so that you're not physically struggling, but it could be emotional struggle. It could be a mental struggle, but the struggle is always there from one stage to the other. Like whether it is for earning the means, earning your bread and butter, raising your children, whatever it is, it's a constant struggling and a striving for everyone. Even the thief, for that matter, even a robber has to struggle to do what he has to. So that is, man is in a constant state of struggle until when? Until he meets his Lord. Now there's for mulaqihi, that is until he meets his Lord. So this meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is 100% sure. Now, what there's an interesting hadith with Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala narrates as far as meeting with the Lord is concerned. And it is said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that we will see our Lord on the day of judgment. And he said, do you have any problems in seeing the sun at the noon where there are no clouds? So they said, yes. What did the Sahaba say? Yes, O Prophet of Allah, we don't have any problem. Do you have any problem in seeing the moon on the night when it is full, when there are no clouds? They said, no. He said, by the one in whose hand is my soul, you will not have any greater problem in seeing your Lord than you do in seeing either of them. That is how you see the moon and how you see the sun so clearly. Similarly, we will also be able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will meet his slave and will say, see now, what is this? Is the conversation between Allah and the people on the day of judgment. So Allah will meet his slave and will say, oh, so and so, did I not honor you, make you a chief, give you a spouse, subjugate horses and camels to you, and give you the opportunity to be a leader? He will say, yes. Then Allah will say, did you think that you would meet me? And the man will say, no. Allah will say, then I will forget you as you forgot me. Then he will meet a second person. And he says, so-and-so, did I not honor you, make you a chief, give you a spouse, subjugate horses to you and camels to you, and give you the opportunity to be a leader? He will say, yes, O Allah. Then he will ask, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask, did you think that you would meet me? And the man will say, no. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say, then I will forget you as you forgot me. Then he'll meet another third person. And Allah will say something similar to that. And the person will say, oh Lord, I believed in you and in your book and in your messenger. And I prayed and I fasted and I gave charity. And he will mention as many good deeds as he can. So this is the description of how it will be like. So when in this verse, when Allah says, Ya ayyuhan nafsu, innaka kadihun ila rabbika kadhan fa mulaki. That is indeed man. You know, O you man, verily you are ever toiling on towards your Lord, painfully toiling, and you shall meet him. So this meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear sisters, we need to reflect. Are we ready to meet Allah? Are we in a state of complete and unconditional submission to Allah? And imagine, what happens on that day when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will ask us? He's going to ask us, where did we spend our times? How did we spend our energies? Where did we spend our youth? Did we learn knowledge or not? Did we acquire knowledge or not? And if we did not know, did we acquire it or not? And if we had it already, then what did we do with that knowledge? Did we make use of that knowledge in the appropriate way or not? and imagine the state of the ummah. Imagine the state of the people who are neither teaching nor learning. When are we going to start learning, sisters? At 83 years of age? And what on this day when we are going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he asks, how did you spend your talents? What about your EQ? What about your IQ? Emotional quotient, the intelligent quotient, the spiritual quotient, and now we have the adversity quotient. Can we tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment, I'm sorry, my apologies, oh my Lord, I forgot. Imagine what Allah will say, then if you forgot, even I'll forget you today. And imagine, what about the dunya? If Allah asks, what about the degrees, your profession, your job, your home, your dresses, your cars, and if your beautiful wardrobes, the best of dunya that you had. It's high time that we wake up, sisters. It's a wake up call. Surah Inshiqaq is very, very clearly asking us to wake up from our slumber. You know, just a couple of months before in Ramadan, we were so hooked on to the glorious Quran and we wanted to do so much of the glorious Quran. And therefore, it's the month of Barakah, because we are so hooked on to obeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the month of Ramadan. And what happens after Ramadan? We wish and we pray that every day is like that of Ramadan. If we can do it in Ramadan, we can do it on all the other days also. Now, from verse number 7 to verse number 14. Verse number 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 onwards. This is the entire picture that what is going to happen on the day of judgment. And how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has divided the entire day of judgment into two categories. And here in this surah, it's a clear depiction. Then Allah says, فَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ بِيَمِينِهِ. Then he who is given his record in his right hand. So these are the people who are the successful people. People of the right hand. People of Yameen. And what happens? Soon will his account be taken as an easy reckoning. فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسِبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا. So in how generally, even in class, you know, when a teacher is about to declare the marks, how it's on, like, you know, it's a climax that is being built up. What is going to happen to me and how am I going to get, whether I'm going to get good marks or not, whether am I successful or not, that climax is going to be built up. Subhanallah. And Allah says, then soon will his account be taken by an easy reckoning. So Hisaba Yasira is an easy reckoning. Now, what is an easy reckoning and what is it that the Sahaba felt? Let us understand that, sisters. The Salaf were so afraid and they were so nervous as far as the reckoning is concerned. What is reckoning is accountability. They had fears in spite of the fact that they knew that they were forgiven. For example, it is narrated that Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala and he used to say, you know, if one of my feet was in paradise and the other was outside it, I would not feel safe from Allah's planning. Similarly, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala and said, I swear by Allah, if a caller was to call me on the day of resurrection, that every person from mankind will go to paradise except one. I would think, rather, I would be convinced that it is Umar, the son of Khattab. That is, he would think that it is Umar, radiallahu ta'ala. We pray and may Allah make us of those who are successful on that day and who belong to the category of the Yameen, who belong to the category of those of the people who are on the right. Inshallah. Ameen. So sisters, you know, as far as reckoning is concerned and as far as فَسَوْفَ يُحَاسَبُ حِسَابًا يَسِيرًا is concerned, it is also narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala an that when the question of accountability came, they usually remembered the verse summa latus alunna yawma izin anin naim. The verse of Surah Taqasur, verse number 8. And what does this verse say? That, you know, then on that day you shall be asked about the delights you have indulged in this world. Now, imagine the state of the Sahaba. And once when this was reminded to the Sahaba, they asked the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Prophet of Allah, what delight will we be asked for? Imagine what so little they had. And yet they are being reminded of, and in response to that, they are asking the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, O Prophet of Allah, what delight will we be asked for? For all we have is two black ones. What are the two black ones? Dates and water. And the enemy is always near. Our swords are always at the ready. Subhanallah. And yet, you know, they were always worried about the fact that summa latus alunna yawma is in anin naim. On that day when you will be asked about the delight. Now, there's another very thought-provoking hadith, sisters, which I would like to draw your attention to. And that is a really very touching one, which has been narrated in Muslim. And the narrator is Abu Hurairah radiallahu ta'ala an. And this is about the three hungry men. Subhanallah, one of them being the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Once what happened, sisters, is that it's an odd time in the night, in the middle of the night, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam comes out in the masjid and he sees Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala an and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. And they both of them are just there. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asks them, what brings you here at this odd hour? And what is their response? They say, it is hunger, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is starvation, O Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And upon that, what is the response of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He says, what has got you out over here has also brought me out over here. Subhanallah. Can you imagine, sisters? Can you just pause for a while and think, the best of the best creation, the Prophet of Allah, who had millions of followers, thousands of followers, thousands of fans, the best, innaka ala khuluqin azim. You know, if we compare him to the present day leaders and the kings that we have, he was the most beloved to people, adored by people, the best of the man who walked this face of this earth, along with the two best men, the non-prophet best men, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala an. And they are hungry. Do you think, you know, when it's like it makes us think so much as to how is it possible that people must have not noticed? The brothers around and the sisters around may have not noticed that they are hungry. The Prophet of Allah is hungry. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq and Hazrat Umar are hungry. But it could be possible. In fact, it is so that it may not have shown in the face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He never showed. He was always so full of smiles, gratitude, contentment and tranquility on his face, subhanallah. And just for a pause for a while, and we see another narration. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala narrates himself that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam noticed hunger on the face of Abu Huraira, some other time this is, and he took him to eat food. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam noticed these things, my dear sisters. And imagine, here is the beloved of Allah and there are three great men and there's nothing to eat. So the Prophet ﷺ says, okay, come, let's go. And they go to this is in Medina. So they go to one of the Ansari's house and they knock at the door and the man is not at home, the Ansar is not at home, so the lady opens the door and she's amazed. She's actually shocked also, and she's amazed also, and she's surprised also. She feels privileged also that the three best men are walking into her house. And you know, what is it like? She's so shocked, and she's so excited and so happy, and she calls them and invites them. And her husband is gone to fetch some fresh water, the hadith says. And by the time he comes back, you know, he says salams, and he's so happy. He says, what good have I done that I deserve these three beautiful guests, you know, in my house? Subhanallah, he gives them the fresh water to drink. And he, you know, after that, he goes to fetch some dates. He gets all the best dates that he could, the fresh one, the dry ones, the raw ones, everything he brings, whatever he can. And soon he takes his knife to, you know, to slaughter a sheep so that he can serve the guests. So as he's going to slaughter, the Prophet ﷺ reminds him that make sure it's not the milking goat, you know, the one who milks. So then, and after that, they eat that. So what is it they're eating? They're having a meal, and they have dates, they have water, and they have some meat. After this, the Prophet ﷺ reminds, and he asks them, and he tells them that we are going to be accountable for this. I mean, can you imagine, after being hungry for days, sisters, a hungry prophet, a hungry best of men, subhanallah, and the best part is they never felt entitled. You know, here we are struggling for the deen. We are at least entitled to so much. This much at least we should get. A'udhu billah. No, they never ever felt entitled. Always so grateful. And another thing about our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam we need to mark is he never ever criticized anything that was given to him. Never ever criticized any food. If he didn't like it, he would keep it aside. He wouldn't eat. But he was so full of gratitude because he felt that criticizing any food is not just the criticism of the food and the maker of the food, but it's the criticism of the one who gives us all this. May Allah make us of those who can be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for what Allah has given us. And the best way to express gratitude is to use all our skills and all the ni'mah that Allah has given us in His service. That is the best way that we can utilize the ni'mah that Allah has given us. So when we meet Him on the day of judgment, at least we have something what we have sent forward. Because we are only going to have on that day what we have sent now. If we are not sending anything, we are going to be barren that day. We are not going to have anything that day. So, you know, the ilm, the life, the wealth, the body, the abilities, the skill, the talent, the intellect, everything, how we used, what we used for, we are going to be accountable on that day. Allah will ask each person about what he was bestowed upon him, his blessings, and whether he fulfilled his rights over him or not. Now, the blessings that we will be asked about are of two types, sisters. Those that are acquired by permissible means and disposed of in lawful ways. He will be asked about whether he thanked for them. And then those that are acquired by prohibited means and disposed of in unlawful ways. He will be asked about how he acquired them and how he disposed them of. So questioning about all this is going to be there. So everyone will be asked about the blessings that he enjoyed in this world. How did he acquire, lawful or unlawful? And was he grateful or ungrateful? And what was the means, how he acquired? And did he use it to obey him or not? Then, as far as the reckoning is concerned, sisters, reckoning on the day of resurrection is going to be of two types. The presentation of deeds, this will be only for the believers. First type is what? Only the deeds is going to be presented. He will be questioned about his deeds, his knowledge and his blessings and Allah bestowed upon him. He will respond in a way that will put him at ease and explain his point in a convincing manner and in a way that will cause blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to continue upon him. And when his sins are shown to him, he will admit them and Allah will conceal the sins for him and Allah will pardon him. So there will be no thorough examination. He will not be interrogated. Okay, there's an interesting hadith to this to support this, sisters, and it is mentioned in Muslim. Aisha radiallahu ta'ala narrates, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever is examined thoroughly at the time of accountability, he will be punished. Then Aisha radiallahu says, I said, didn't Allah say he surely will receive an easy reckoning here according to verse number 8, what we are doing? And the Prophet ﷺ said, that is only the presentation of the deeds. So we are not going to be questioned. That is only the presentation. For the believers, what's going to happen? Only the presentation of the deeds, sisters. There's another narration in which Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala narrates, I asked the Messenger ﷺ about the easy reckoning. I said, O Messenger of Allah, what is easy reckoning? And he said, a man's sins will be shown to him, then he will be pardoned for them. Whenever he is examined thoroughly at the reckoning, he will be doomed. So if he is going to be examined, he's going to be destruction called, he's going to be doomed then. Now there's, so that means what? One is only going to be presentation of the deeds. That is one type of reckoning. Now listen to this beautiful. Presentation is the presentation of our deeds, our book. The entire book is going to be shown. Now, Bukhari and Muslim both narrate this interesting hadith, sisters. And Ibn Umar narrates, he says that I heard the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam say. What did the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam say? Allah will draw the believer close and will screen him. And will say, so imagine now it is me and Allah alone, okay? And Allah will put a screen. And Allah will ask me, do you admit such and such a sin? That means who's there? There's a screen and only me and my Lord. And Allah will ask me, Allah will ask one single believer, do you admit such and such a sin? Do you admit such and such a sin? And he will say, yes, oh my Lord, I admit to that. And the person will feel very sad. Then when he has admitted his sin and thinks, and Allah will give the list, you know, did you do this? Did you do this? And I as a person, you know, will feel really now Allah is going to put me into the hell. Nauzubillah. Because of the number of sins that we do. It will be such a state, you know, the believer will be so scared. And then Allah will say, I have concealed them for you in the world and I will forgive for them this day. And I will give you forgiveness this day. Then he will be given the book of his good deeds. But as far as the disbeliever and the hypocrite is concerned, the witnesses will say for them, these are the ones who lied against you, O Lord. No doubt the curse of Allah is on the zalimun. Like Allah says in Surah Hud. This is for the wrongdoers, the polytheists, the oppressors, especially the hypocrites. And all those who have rejected the truth. But as far as the believer is concerned, Allah will talk to the believer one-to-one and ask, and we admit our sins and we say, and Allah will say, I had hidden them. I hid them for you. I concealed them for you in dunya. I will also conceal them for you now. And he will be forgiven. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks in verse number 9. And he will turn to his people rejoicing. وَيَنْكَلِبُوا إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا. So what will he do? The believer will then turn to his family in a very happy way, rejoicing. And now, as far as, you know, there are so many sisters who keep asking this question that will we be with our loved ones on the day of judgment in the year after in Jannah? You know, supposing if you have a righteous person in the family and the entire family is not so righteous. They will be lower levels of Jannah. these people can actually bring the family to the higher levels of Jannah. This has been mentioned in chapter 52, verse number 21. You can actually call, Allah will upgrade your family to you. Therefore, if your family is on the right path, if one of the sister, one of the brothers is doing righteous deeds, please help that brother or the sister. Please be a part of supporting system to the brother or the sister. Whoever is the family member who is ahead in the work of deen is more righteous. Help the person in whatever capacity you can. Because why? Because on the in Jannah, inshallah, inshallah, you will be raised to a higher level to whichever family member who's on the highest level, you can reach to that level, inshallah. And imagine, sisters, you know, what will Jannah be like without a family? You know, even here, do you enjoy going on an outing on a hill station all by yourself? You don't even enjoy if you're alone. You the first thing you come back, even if you go for some official work, you know, to a very nice hill station, the first thing you come back and you tell the family, oh, I missed y'all so, so much. You don't even enjoy any beautiful scenery without somebody to share with. So imagine Jannah without the family, how it's going to be like. Allah does not want that to happen. And therefore, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, we'll upgrade the people, our family in Jannah along with us. And that is why even our duty is to take so much care of the family. The family deserves our love, our affection. In case if they are not able to understand, if they are not at par with you in deen, your duty is to, in a loving way, in an affectionate way, be the best to the family. Beautify the deen for them, my dear sisters. Do it in the most loving manner for them. They are more deserving. The best of you is the one who's the best to the family. You know, unfortunately, we have people who do the best of preaching outside, but they are worse to the family, na'uzubillah. That is something uncalled for. You know, you become like beasts in the family. Auzubillah. For outside, it's very good. It's very nice to be goody-goody outside in the masjid with the friends. But the real test is to be the best to the brothers and sisters who fight on and off, who want to take away your rights. But only for the sake of Allah, we've got to be good to the family. Like Allah mentions the dua, Rabbana hablana min azwajina zurriyatina qurrata ayun wajalna lil muttaqina imama. You know how much Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala used to, you know, encourage. He used to always make it a point to wake up the family for tahajjud. In fact, it was a must in his house that each family member has to pray tahajjud. So kindness to the family in case of deen is of utmost importance, sisters. We have to go out of the way. We remember Yaqub alayhi salam asking, even on the deathbed, he was so worried. He asked the children, who are you going to worship after me? And they assured him that we are going to worship only Allah. What is our concern for our families? Are we working with our families? It's time to reflect. It's time to think. Or is it that I do my own salah and I care a hang? You know, whether or not my brother is praying or not. How many times do we genuinely pray, my dear sisters, for our family? If not every salah, every morning and evening, do we genuinely pray for our families that Allah help them to understand the deen and make them amongst the most righteous? That should be a part of our dua every day, in fact. And then Allah says in the next verse, وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ وَرَاءَ ظَهْرِهِ. But then this is the second category. So first we saw the people who are going to be people of Yameen, and now, but he who is given his record behind his back, soon will he cry for perdition, for destruction. فَسَوْفَ يَدُوْ سُبُورًا وَيَسْلَى سَعِيرًا. And he will enter into the blazing fire, enraged, towering flames. He's going to be into the blazing fire. So these are the people who did not bother, who did not care about the hereafter. They are the people who did not think that we are going to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the people who, you know, rejoiced, thoughtlessly rejoicing, shall be made to weep on that day. وَيَسْلَى سَعِيرًا, he will be in the hellfire. إِنَّهُ كَانَ فِي أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا, truly did he go about among his people rejoicing. What did he do in this world? He was rejoicing. Surur is actually the secret joy, inner joy, you know, of the heart. So he was busy enjoying in this world. Truly he did think that he would not have to return to us. He would not have to return to the Lord, he thought. Nay, nay, for his Lord was ever watchful of him. So sisters, here right from verse number 7 until verse number 14, all these verses describe, they show a clear cut picture. And what are the two characteristics of people who are enjoying in this world and the people of those who have the book in their left hand? Two characteristic features that this verse number 13 and 14 speak is what? First is that he was always waiting for enjoyment and entertainment. And we see today, what do we see? You know, so often people speak of, I'm so bored. I want something different. I want to enjoy something. This is not entertaining enough. I want something better, 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 and then the best. And to the extent, you know, that you're not satisfied even with the natural things. And then you have the whole lot of, na'uzu billah, you know, the wanting to do anything which is beyond the natural. And then you have the filthy things that one wants to do. Right from, you know, you don't even have the two genders today. It's like the male, the female, the transgenders and the lesbians and the homosexuals. It's not a full stop at that. You have a whole spectrum of genders to the extent that the education system today says, and in most advanced countries, what are they preaching and what are they teaching? They say that leave it to the imagination of the child. You don't have to dictate whether it's a he or a she. Let them decide whatever they want to be. We are free beings. So let them decide whatever they want to be. Whether they want to be a gay, they want to be a homosexual, they want to be... So there's a whole spectrum of genders. Auzubillah. May Allah save us and may Allah protect us. So that's the distinct feature. You know, they always wanted entertainment. Entertainment in everything. You know, you hardly find children today who are sitting and reading genuine books. Why? Because we have always given them media in their hands. And the second characteristic feature is no fear of meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No question of accountability, just care a hang, you know, you get this life once, so live this life, enjoy it, and who cares what's going to happen later? That attitude is something which is very, very scary. And here when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke of, you know, وَيَنْقَلِبُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا, and here Allah says again, إِنَّهُ كَانَ فِي أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا. These people also see, mark the difference between those who are the people of the right hand and the people of the left hand. The people who are successful and the people who are disgraceful on the day of judgment. Mark the difference between the two. They both are going to go to their ahl. And what is their ahl? Their family. Who is their family? The family actually is the spiritual family also. Like the family of Ibrahim alayhi salam is not his father. The family of Nuh alayhi salam is not his son. The family of Lut alayhi salam is not his wife, right? The family of Asiya is not her husband. This is the family that actually belongs, the entire spiritual family that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is speaking of over here. The family that even went before, right from Adam alayhi salam, all the family of the believers. So subhanallah, it is this family that we are going to belong to, inshallah, the larger family. And he thought that coming back again to the person who's got the record in his left hand, what he thought that I don't have to return to the Lord. Doesn't he remember that he has given a genuine amana, where Allah speaks in the glorious Quran, Allah speaks about the oath that we have taken? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked us, that's there in chapter number 7, verse number 172, where Allah speaks of that. That before the creation, from the lions of Adam alayhi salam, when we all were there in the form of ruh, and he asked all of us, and we the creation of Allah, we took it upon ourselves, alastu bi rabbikum, he asked, am I not your Lord? And that is when the entire conversation takes place, and we told that Allah, we want to be human beings. The all the other creations, the sky, the sun and the moon and the earth and all the other creations refused, and we said we want to do it. We took the amana upon ourselves. And today the same man denies meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in verse number 15, nay, for his Lord was ever watchful of him. Bala inna rabbahu kana bihi basira. Says that Allah says that, you know, this is something which is inevitable. This is something which is going to happen, and Allah is watching us. Everything is being noted. We are under constant surveillance. Everything is being recorded, sisters. Nothing is random. You know, just imagine, we need to give reminders to ourselves every time. And that is why these surahs, that is why Allah says that you have to keep on reading the glorious Quran. You know, how do we give reminders to ourselves? How do we remind ourselves oftentimes? Just three tips that I thought of to remind ourselves every time, because man forgets. You know, here also where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhal insanu innaka kadihun, in verse number 6, what he has said, insan is from nisyan. That means what? Forgetful. Man is forgetful. Man keeps forgetting, and therefore the reminder is required. So how do we remind ourselves, sisters? Just three tips that I thought of, three important points. We can come up with many more, but this is just simple, basic, you know. What we can do is in our beautiful wardrobes that we have, we can put a tag or a note there on top, which can mention my permanent dress is going to be what? My permanent dress is going to be the two white pieces of cloth. So every time when we think of changing the wardrobe, of changing the dresses, you know, at least we think of the fact that I'm going to meet my Lord. My final dress is going to be just two plain pieces of white cloth. Secondly, another way to remember constantly is also we can put a dua either on the refrigerator or wherever, you know, you feel you'll easily access this. You'll be able to see that. You can put a poster there, the dua for meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma inni asaluka lazzata nazri ila wajhikal kareem wa shauka ila likaik. Oh Allah, help me to, you know, give me the honor of seeing your face over and over again, and the desire to meet you. So we can put that dua. Also, another third reminder could be in the form of when we stand in front of the mirror and we look at ourselves, you know, we ask ourselves at that point of time, am I in a state of submission to Allah? Am I ready to meet my Lord if I am called today? Because we don't know, sisters, when is the final day when we are going to be called. So we stand in front of the mirror and we ask ourselves, am I ready today to meet my Lord? Am I in a state of submission or not? So bala inna rabbahu kana bihi basira. Nay. Your Lord is always watching you. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse number 16, Fala uksimu bishafaq. Now here is the last part which begins. The next part which begins. No? And this is the part where again Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taking oath. So I do call to witness the ruddy glow of the sunset. Now this is the nature which keeps changing. Allah is speaking about the sunset, witness the taking an oath of the sunset, wallayli wama wasak. That is the night and its homing. the night when it returns, while Kamari is at Tasak, the moon in her fullness. So all this, like, you know, you have the day and then slowly it moves into the night. You have the full sun and then it sets into different stages and then finally it sets. Similarly, you have the moon and it turns into, you know, the thin line, and then it becomes, and then as it becomes a complete moon one day, the full moon. So the different stages of the changes in the nature. You shall surely travel from one stage to another. Latarkabunna tabakan antabak. That is you shall surely move from one stage to the other. Yeah, I'll post the dua later, inshallah, sister. Then Allah says, what then is the matter with them that they believe not? Then what has happened to man that why doesn't man believe? Why is still man into this thoughtless indulgence into self? Why is still, you know how fleeting this world is. You see so many people dying, and yet why is it so that man doesn't believe? So it's a rhetorical question that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking, that in spite of all this, you know, the stages of the creation, how it's happening, everything. Similarly, man is also going through different stages. Yet what has happened to man? Why he doesn't listen? And then Allah says, and when the Quran is read to them, they fall not into prostration. In spite of all this that is happening, man does not fall into prostration. Subhanallah. And here, you know, sisters, this process of passing by from one stage to the other stage, which Allah speaks of in verse number 19, latarkabunna tabakan antabak. You shall surely travel from one stage to the other stage. As far as this particular verse is concerned, Mufassirin have given a couple of different opinions of that. And this is mentioned in Bukhari, and Ibn Abbas's opinion, it refers to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the different stages in his mission, in his life. So according to Ibn Abbas, this latarkabunna tabakan an tabak refers to the different stages of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the mission, and his mission, what he went through. There's a second opinion of Abdullah bin Masood. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it refers to the Prophet will pass through various levels of the heavens, like he did in Isra and Miraj. So he says it refers to that. There's another third opinion. Scholars have said that it refers to the Muslims will face a new situation every 20 years. Okay. Then there's a fourth opinion which says that generally it refers to people will pass through various stages in life, that is youth, the childhood, then youth, then old age, different levels of poverty, wealth, riches, health, sickness, old age, the ups and downs of life. It refers to that. Then there's another opinion which refers to the movement of all that exists, of all the creation, movement of all the creation that exists from one stage to the next stage. A fundamental law which is very, very evident in all creations, that all creations are going to come to an end. That is the death, right? So that is one of the opinions. But generally it refers to what? Latarkabunna tabakan antabak. You shall certainly travel from one stage to the other. Tarkaban is you're going to ride from one stage to another. Rakaba is actually what? To ride. It's a horse riding, okay? Tabakan antabak is from one stage to the other stage. And the different stages are like, you know, you like, even if we take the example of our of human beings, like you're born a little baby, an infant. And then what happens is that before that, you are in the womb of the mother. So if we start from the womb of the mother, then you're born, you're just a little infant. Then you start toddling, you start walking, then you start talking. Then you become a little independent. Then you grow up full youth, blooming youth. Then you become powerful and you are almost into a full developed being, very powerful, reaching a little more elder, then more powerful than your parents. And then you turn to old age. then dementia and sickness, you can't even walk, sometimes you can't even talk, and then you face death, the journey of death, and then barzakh, and then resurrection again until you meet your Lord. So one stage to the other stage. That is the most recognized meaning of this particular verse, subhanallah. And a similar verse is mentioned in Surah Hadid, that is chapter number 57, verse number 20, where Allah specifically speaks, you know, of these stages. اِعْلَمُوا إِنَّمَا الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا لَيْبُ وَلَحْمُ وَزِينَةٌ وَتَفَاخُرٌ بَيْنَكُمْ وَتَقَاصُرٌ فِي الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَوْلَادِ. That is, that know that the life of this world is only play and amusement, pomp and mutual boasting amongst yourself and rivalry in respect of wealth and children. So Allah is speaking here about the different stages, you know, and it is so true. Just in one part of the verse, everything has been described. This verse concisely summarizes. It shows the entire life of the human being. The picture is very, very clear, right from childhood. So first is you're in an infant stage, a baby, then you become a toddler. And what is most important to the toddler? Laibun. Laib is what? To play. Yeah? Which is what toddlers are engrossed in. Then you come to the next stage is what? A little older you become, where entertainment becomes an amusement is of most important. Lahun. Lahu. Then a little later teens, what are the teenagers obsessed with? Pomp and glitter and appearances and how you look. So zinatun. Then you become independent, you make money, you get married, you want to boast, you want to show off. That is tafakhurum. Boasting, show off, you know, competition. And then it is the stage when you get married, you have children. So rivalry in wealth and children. Tafakhurum. So that has been stated in Surah Hadid, chapter 57, verse number 20. So that is what gives us a complete picture of what this one stage to the other stage is. Then Allah speaks in the other verses that you shall surely travel from one stage to the other. What then has happened to man? Why he doesn't believe? And when the Quran is recited, he does not want to prostrate. Now this is as far as Sajdatul Tilawa. So inshallah, sisters, please do remember to do Sajda Tilawa after we finish, inshallah. It's not a fard, but it is highly recommended though. So here what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, that these people, even in spite of hearing the Quran, they do not prostrate. Now this is one meaning, is the simple prostration. They do not bow down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The other complete meaning is complete submission. That means even after seeing the signs of Allah, even after being given the different signs that Allah has shown them, the different ayat that Allah has shown them, but in spite of that, they do not believe in Allah. They do not submit to Allah. So it's not just the mere prostration, physical prostration, but it also means emotionally, mentally, psychologically bowing to the commandment of Allah. But on the contrary, what do? The unbelievers reject. But Allah has full knowledge of what they secrete. That is what they gather in their breasts. Good and bad, all Allah knows what do they have. So announce to them a penalty most grievous, a painful torment. Announce to them what? A painful torment. For bashir hum bi azabin aleem. See, this is sarcasm that Allah is using in response to the sarcasm of the disbelievers, because they kept asking, so what happened to the day of judgment that was about to come? When is it coming? Nauzubillah, they used to make fun and mock at the believers, saying that you're speaking about the day of judgment since a long time. So when is it coming? What happened to it? It stopped a what in between? Literally, in fact, they used to get the bones from the graveyards and they used to show the bones to the believers and ask the Prophet ﷺ, you think your Lord is going to raise from these bones? He's going to resurrect once again? He's going to bring those who are dead to life from these bones? That is what they used to ask. And in response to them, Allah is saying, فَبَشِّرْهُمْ بِعَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. So give them the bashara. Give them the glad tiding of what? Of the painful punishment, of a painful torment. Except to those who believe and work righteous deeds. And for them is a reward that will never fail. إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَآمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَهُمْ أَجْرٌ غَيْرُ مَمْنُونَ. So that is the people who are going to be people of reflection. For them is something who are struggling here today to understand, to implement, to please Allah. Those who are using their resource. You know, sisters, Surah Inshiqaq is a very strong reminder for us. It's important that we reflect upon the verses. And today, if we reflect, unfortunately, we are facing now as an ummah, you know, this verse that man thinks that he's not going to go back to his Lord. Unfortunately, what we are facing now is an ummah we have. Today, what we are facing as an ummah, we have not faced in any time in the history. It's incredibly important to think really, you know, it's a threat of disillusion of the human soul. It's like, you know, we are being ripped apart from our very fitra. We are being ripped apart from our very fitra, from our very natural disposition. The soul is completely disillusioned. The angels refused, all the other creations refused, but the human took it upon himself to take an amana. You know, we as an ummah are collectively facing the crisis today. That is completely unparalleled in the history of Islam. And imagine what's going to happen in the near future. Like you see, the times that we are in, these kind of times were never faced earlier. Like even at the time of, you know, even at the time of Lut alayhi salam, Saleh alayhi salam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, there was one evil and that evil was very rampant. But today we have a mixture of all the evils today in society. It's a very, very scary scenario. Indeed, it's a very scary picture, sisters. No other period is equivalent to the period we are in now. And the greatest reason for this, my dear sisters, is mass communication and social media. Really, I mean, this is very threatening. And the reason for this is the power that the disbelievers have today, the power that the kuffar have today in their hands to attack the Muslims in our very homes. In the hearts of our homes, we have them attacking us. Everywhere in the world, you see through satellite dishes and through the internet, even in the poorest of the houses, you may not have food to eat, but you'll have the internet. And this is a deliberate and a purposeful plan, making internet cheaply available across the globe, especially in the Muslim world. The filth that is polluting the minds and the hearts of our youth, the filth that is they are being brainwashed day in and day out. Not just the youth, the people of middle age, the old age, day in and day out, everyone. They are programming, my dear sisters. Who is doing the tarbiyah? Earlier it was the TV. Earlier it was that idiot box in the house. You know, the shaitan sitting in the house. Earlier it was that, but now it has come in the palm of our hands. A calamity, a massive impact it's having. Massive power. It is so powerful. It is completely brainwashing. And it is a very tricky thing. It has the ability to influence masses. And we have let the devil inside our drawing rooms. We have let the shaitan into our bedrooms. We allow the devil, we allow the shaitan to raise our children, to teach our youth, to corrupt their minds, and to inflict oppression upon their hearts. This is something extraordinary that It is feeding the minds and the souls of our youth and our children. It's all junk in the mind, sisters, junk in the heart, leading to junk people. It is as if the Ummah is sleeping. We are sleeping deep sleep in slumber. And we are losing our children to the Netflix. And what it is going to take, how much more of humanity we are going to lose before we get up? How much more pollution is going to fill our hearts? How much more haram is going to go into our hearts? Imagine the weight, the responsibility that the Ummah has today. We are not like other people, my dear sisters. We are the best of people. We do not want to be amongst Ghairil Maghdubi Alayhim, incurring the wrath of Allah. The intelligent man is the one who learns from the tribulations of the others. The intelligent person is the one who learns from other people's tribulations and does not call tribulation upon one's own self. It's an awakening call, not waiting for tribulation to come upon ourselves. We need to turn in repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have to change for the sake of our children, for the sake of our generation, sisters, to become real people, not junk people running into junk malls. More and more of it. And how much more do we want? Giving importance to the lowest pursuits of society. It's okay, we make mistakes. We have our own shortcomings. But we have to be smart enough to turn into repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and treasure our generations and treasure our children and our youth. Sincere repentance is required, and sincerely we need to think, what is our plan for our upcoming generations? What is our plan for our children? And that only can bring back life. Give back life to our souls. Otherwise, we are like dead people, just eating, you know, enjoying and going back to sleep. Is that what life is all about? We have to desire. There has to be a passionate desire to connect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the only solution. And He loves us and He's most forgiving. He's Al-Wadud, He's Al-Ghafoor. He is the one who forgives, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our sins, and may He include us amongst those who are the people of the right hand, who can go back to our ahl, to our family, enjoying in a state of everlasting bliss, inshallah. Wa qulu qawli haza innahu wastaghfirullah li wa lakum innahu ghafurur rahim. Jazakallahu khairan kaseeran. Over to Sister Dina.
May Allah make us the ones who receive the book with our right hand and give us easy account. May Allah protect us from the fitna of our current times and give us the iman and strength to rise against the fitna. Ameen. Jazakallah khairan sada for the lesson today. Next, we will have the youth session with Sister Amina with the topic Khalid Al-Walid. So I pass on the presentation to Sister Amina. Over to you, Sister.
Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in, amma ba'd. Fa'audhu billahi minash shaytanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa ahlul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. I welcome you all with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Today, inshallah, I will be talking about one of the greatest companions of the Prophet, peace be upon him. A companion who was a soldier. He was a commander. He was a conqueror. He crushed the superpowers of his time. He crushed the Persian Empire. He crushed the Roman Empire. He conquered Iraq. He conquered Iran. He conquered Armenia. He conquered Jordan. He conquered Syria. He was the undefeated commander, the undefeated ruler, the sword of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu is the greatest general the Ummah has ever seen. The greatest military genius after the Prophet, peace be upon him, that the world has ever witnessed. A lot of us do not realize that Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu did not begin his life as a military warrior. In fact, his life was akin to growing up as a prince because his father was the chief of one of the tribes of Quraysh. And his father was Al-Walid ibn al-Mughira al-Makhzumi. Khalid radiallahu anhu was the man to whom Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Khalid bin Walid, on the basis of your intelligence, understanding and foresight, I was very hopeful that one day you would finally accept Islam. A strong and sturdy physique, tall stature, broad shoulders, dignified bearing and eagle-eyed with a brilliant intellect, noble thoughts and firm determination. This was the grand personality of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, an unparalleled rider, an expert swordsman. He was noted for his courage and foresight in planning. In the Battle of Uhud, fighting on behalf of the Kuffar, he displayed his expertise and valor. But in the Battle of Mu'ta, this was the very same Muslim hero who, by his brilliant strategic planning and courage, not only saved most of the Mujahideen, but led them to one of their greatest triumphs. The palaces of Rome and Persia trembled at the coming of the name of Khalid radiallahu anhu as he tore through the ranks of the enemy in the battlefield. When the Kuffar heard the name of this fearless man, they were shaken by a terrible and dreadful panic. And his stormy attacks and victories stunned the world. And the Prophet, peace be upon him, gave him the title Saifullah, the sword of Allah. He is recognized in the world's military history as one of the greatest generals of all time. In his youth, the qualities of foresight and planning bloomed to perfection. And the story of his conversion to Islam is one of great interest. Haris bin Hisham related that Khalid bin Walid used to say that before he accepted Islam, almost in every engagement, he used to enter the battlefield, challenging the Prophet, peace be upon him. But each time, his majesty and nobility seemed to spread an aura which seemed to enter the heart of Khalid radiallahu anhu, until finally Allah sowed in his heart the love of Islam. On one occasion, when the Prophet, peace be upon him, was leading the Dhuhr Salah in the battlefield with the Muslim army behind him, Khalid radiallahu anhu was tempted to take advantage of this invaluable opportunity and attack the Muslims, who would thereby suffer irrevocable losses. But some invisible force seemed to hold him back, and he could not muster up enough courage to do it. Then again, in the same battlefield, the Prophet, peace be upon him, led the Asr prayer. Again, the thought came to Khalid radiallahu anhu that he should not lose this chance to attack the Muslim army as they are engrossed in prayer. But it seemed as if his feet could not move, and he realized that some unseen power was protecting the Prophet, peace be upon him, and that surely Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would one day conquer not only the whole of Arabia, but the whole of the world. After the Treaty of Hudaybiyah, Khalid radiallahu anhu received a letter from his brother who had already accepted Islam, telling him that the Prophet, peace be upon him, asked him of Khalid radiallahu anhu and said that it is not possible that his intelligent, perceptive brother should be deprived of the blessings of Islam. And this letter inclined Khalid radiallahu anhu towards Islam. He felt that his life had to take a turn for the best possible future. And during this time, he dreamt that he was moving of a tiny, dark, dingy, and airy place. He dreamt that he was moving out of a tiny, dark, dingy, and airless place into a very green, fertile land. And when he woke up, he was extremely pleased. And then he made up his mind to go to Medina. And he wished that he would find someone to join him. So he expressed his intention to Uthman bin Talha, who agreed to join him. And on their way, they also met Amr bin al-As radiallahu anhu. And all three of them were on their way to Medina, going to meet the Prophet, peace be upon him, with the same intention to accept Islam. And when they met the Prophet, peace be upon him, in Medina, they greeted him respectfully. And then pledged their allegiance to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this was when the Prophet, peace be upon him, told Khalid radiallahu anhu, I was sure, taking into consideration your brilliance, your wisdom and foresight, that one day you would accept Islam as your religion. Later, Khalid radiallahu anhu narrated his dream to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu told him, the narrow dark room in your life is disbelief and shirk, and the green fertile expanse in your life is Islam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought you out of the narrowness and darkness of ignorance into the radiance and enlightenment of Islam. May this be auspicious for you. From then onwards, Khalid radiallahu anhu gave himself mind, body, and soul for the great cause of Islam. After his pledge of allegiance, he gave the rest of his life to fighting for the truth against the forces of evil, cruelty, and barbarism. At the most critical of times, he did not display the slightest degree of fear or hopelessness or despair. Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu accomplished such daring exploits that the world was lost in wonder and amazement. His great deeds of daring heroism and bravery were acknowledged and admired even by his enemies. The Battle of Mutah was the first war in which Khalid radiallahu anhu took part after his conversion to Islam. But he fought here as a foot soldier, and the Prophet, peace be upon him, had chosen three leaders, Zayd bin Haritha radiallahu anhu, and if he died, then Ja'far bin Abi Talib radiallahu anhu was supposed to take responsibility. And if he died, then Abdullah bin Rawaha should take over the command. During this battle, all the three leaders displayed marvelous heroism and attained martyrdom. But the morale of the Muslims was now at its lowest. When one of the companions lifted up the flag and handed it to Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu, and he asked him to take over the leadership of the army. And after the approval of all the soldiers, Khalid radiallahu anhu took over the command. And when the Prophet, peace be upon him, got to know of this, he said, a sword from the swords of Allah has taken over the command of the Muslims. And Khalid radiallahu anhu raised high the flag and fought so fiercely and firmly that he broke 9 swords in this battle, and the enemy was thwarted. Another very interesting anecdote associated with Khalid radiallahu anhu in the Battle of Yarmouk was when a Roman general asked Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu if he would answer his question truthfully, to which Khalid radiallahu anhu agreed. He asked if the Prophet, peace be upon him, had received a special sword from heaven and given it to him, because his opponents always seemed to meet with defeat. Khalid radiallahu anhu said that he had certainly not received any sword from heaven. The Roman general then asked him, "Why are you then called the sword of Allah?" Khalid al-Dhanan replied, "It was because Allah had sent a messenger to guide them. Some of the people had sworn allegiance to the messenger and followed him with their hearts and souls and obeyed him, while others rejected him and chose to oppose him. And he, Khalid radiallahu anhu himself, had been one of his worst enemies until Allah inclined his heart towards Islam, and he then joined the band of Muslims. And then on one of the occasions, the Prophet, peace be upon him, told him, "O Khalid, you are the sword of Allah, which has been made to annihilate the kuffar." And thus he came to be known as the sword of Allah. And after this incident, the Roman general was deeply moved and accepted Islam. He now fought as an ordinary soldier in the Battle of Yarmouk under the command of Khalid bin Walid and attained martyrdom. Also, during the caliphate of Abu Bakr radiallahu anh, Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anh played a leading role in the wars of the Ridda, the wars against the apostates. And Umar radiallahu anhu, during his caliphate, dismissed Khalid bin Walid from being the commander-in-chief and replaced him with Abu Ubaidah bin al-Jarrah. And he said, "I did not dismiss Khalid because I was angry with him or because of any misconduct on his part. Rather, the people were too attached to him, and I feared that Allah would leave them to him and they would be tested because of him. I wanted them to know that Allah is the one who brings victory, so that they would not be confused about this fact." The point that Umar radiallahu anhu was trying to make here is that the Muslims shouldn't start thinking that victory comes from Khalid bin Walid, because victory comes from Allah and Allah alone. And after all the great wars that Khalid radiallahu anhu took part in, now the great general Khalid bin Walid, who struck terror in the hearts of the enemies, was lying on his deathbed. He was weeping profusely, and he said that he always wanted to attain martyrdom and had fought in many battles, hoping to achieve it. He said, "There is no place on my body the size of a hand span that has not received a blow from the sword or been pierced by an arrow or a spear. And here I am, dying on my bed. May the cowards never prosper. I sought death in the places where it may be sought, but it was only decreed that I should die on my own bed." And that is when it was said to him, "O Khalid, the day the Prophet, peace be upon him, named you the sword of Allah, it was impossible for you to die on a battlefield. For if you died on a battlefield, that would have meant that the sword of Allah was broken by an infidel, and the sword of Allah would never be broken." SubhanAllah. In the Battle of Mutah, Khalid radiallahu anh broke 9 swords. Why? Because those were the swords of Khalid. As for Khalid radiallahu anhu himself, he was the sword of Allah, and he could not be broken. Khalid radiallahu anh asked Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu to execute his will. And Umar radiallahu anhu wept and mourned deeply upon his death. And when the women mourned the death of Khalid, Umar radiallahu anhu said, "Let them weep for Khalid as long as they are not eulogizing him or babbling. For the likes of Khalid bin Walid, let the weepers weep." And the truth is, there will never be another Khalid bin Walid. As Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu said, "Women will never give birth to the likes of Khalid bin Walid." May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevate his ranks, and may he unite us with Khalid bin Walid and his likes on the Day of Judgment. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the bravery and courage like that of Khalid bin Walid radiallahu anhu. And may he choose us to be amongst those who raise high the banner of Islam. Ameen. Wa akhiru da'wana an alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah make us amongst one who can contribute something to Islam, just like Khalid bin Al-Walid, radiyallahu anhu. Jazakallahu khairan, Sister Amina. Now we proceed with our next session, which is the Q&A. If anyone has any question, feel free to post it in the chat and we'll have Ustaz, inshallah, answer your question. In the meantime, I will try to flash the dua that Ustaz mentioned earlier. So please bear with me.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. So some of the sisters were asking for the three reminders that I mentioned. The reminders were, the first that I mentioned is that, you know, that's just in order to remind ourselves, because man is, you know, forgetful by the very nature. We keep forgetting things, and therefore iman, it is said, it increases and it falls. So the best way to do is to remind ourselves often. Because when we are caught up in this dunya, we hardly remember. So one of the ways is to paste a reminder on our wardrobe, somewhere where it is easily visible for us, that my final costume that I'm going to wear, my final dress is going to be the two white pieces of cloth. Right? So that helps us remind ourselves that what is my final destination. The second is this dua that I thought of, is such a beautiful dua which makes us passionately think of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which bonds us with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and which helps us desire to see His face over and over again. Because it is said that in Jannah, we will all not be able to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There'll be a category of people who will be sent salams by Allah. There will be selected people who will be able to see the wajh of Allah, but they will be only the selected ones who will be able to see the wajh of Allah over and over again. And there, that is the best thing to do, sisters, to be able to see the face of Allah will be the most honorable and the most privileged thing to do, which believers will enjoy there. So we keep praying to Allah this dua. Allahumma inni as'aluka lazzatan nazri ila wajhikal kareem wa shauqa ila liqa'ik. You know, Allah, give us the delight of gazing at your face, at your countenance, and eagerness of meeting you, inshallah. And it is said that the one who is eager to meet Allah, Allah is also eager to meet him. The one who does not want to meet Allah, Allah also does not want to meet him. So may Allah make us of those who are eager to meet him, inshallah. And the third reminder. The third reminder is, when you stand in front of the mirror, you ask yourself, you know, because when we are in front of the mirror, we are so engrossed into looking at our physical defects or our physical beauty. If we are in a positive state of mind, okay, we think of, you know, how nice we are, how beautiful we are, whatever. But at that point of time, another little thought, you know, is worthwhile, that, am I in a state of submission to Allah? Am I really in a state of obedience to Allah? What if the death comes to me now? You know, nobody is sure whether I'm going to live tonight or not. So when we stand in front of the mirror, ask yourself that, am I ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If He was to call me now, am I in a state of submission? And am I in such a state that Allah will be happy with me? So hope that answers. And yeah, and I think there is one question on atheism, right? one of the sisters has mentioned that one of my relative in Canada is inclined towards atheism. May Allah protect us all. How can I approach him to talk about this subject? Yeah, it's very important, sister, first of all, because if it's a cousin, it's a very close family, you maintain good ties. And of course, if you're not in a position, if you don't know much about how to go about, because you need to approach the person depending upon the background the person has. If he's from a science faculty, then you can give proofs to the person as far as the scientific facts that are mentioned in the Quran. So, you know, you can prove the existence of God by giving scientific proofs from the glorious Quran. But then he has to believe that Quran is a book of Allah. If he doesn't believe that Quran is from Allah, that is why he's going towards atheism most probably. So then first proving to him the existence of God, I would strongly recommend that you watch Dr. Zakir Naik's, there are various lectures that he has given, especially to deal with atheism. If you can watch Concept of God in Islam and How to Prove the Existence of God to an Atheist. So you can go about first, write down all the points, make yourself ready, and in a nice way, inshallah, if the cousin is willing to have an open discussion, nothing like it, alhamdulillah. So you can start. But earlier the better, sister, because it's a very, very sorry state of affairs. A great amount of population is getting into atheism. And, you know, there are innumerable books and material that is there across the internet about atheism. And there are very many Muslims also, nauzubillah, getting into the thoughts of atheism. May Allah save and may Allah protect us, subhanallah. In fact, the most, you know, popular books that are written in about atheism are like, majority, the maximum number of translations that have been done is that in Arabic language. Can you believe that? And I was wondering, why in the world have they got it translated into Arabic? That's because the Arabs want it. They want to read the books on atheism. Subhanallah. You know? So again, it boils down to the same of preserving our generations and being careful what our children are watching over the internet. And what recently, a couple of days ago, I had posted an hour and a half video. You know, I don't know if you all have seen it, the Deen Show, which has openly discussed with a teacher how she has brought it to the notice, you know, of the Muslims and the authorities. She being a non-Muslim, she stands against it firmly, saying that it's something very detrimental to our generations to come. Yeah, so I strongly recommend that we should be aware of what's happening across. And today itself, Sister Rifa, she shared with me, the books are in Arabic also. The Arabic books also are, specifying and bifurcating the genders. So they are also showing in children books, in children story books, they are showing the different genders. So there they also have shown homosexuals and lesbians. Allahu Akbar. You know, subhanallah, that means even across the Muslim world, it's there. Not just the European countries, not just America and UK and Canada. Subhanallah. You know, and it's high time, sisters. That's why there were a couple of announcements that I wanted to make. But before that, if there's any other question, we can have that and then we can.
Yes, Ustaza, there are a few questions that's from Facebook and also sent to me privately. The first question is, a sister has a question on how not to overthink about sins that we have made before.
Okay. So this is about if a person has sinned earlier and, yes, the person is overthinking. So how not to do that, right?
That's the question? Yes, that's correct.
So, sisters, as far as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is concerned, He is Al-Ghafoor Al-Wadood. You know, it is written before the creation of everything. It was written on the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that His mercy overpowers His wrath. Subhanallah, we have such a merciful God. Even if the sins are equal to the amount of the raindrops, even if the sins are equal to the drops of sand on the face of the earth, but if there is sincere repentance, Allah forgives all the sins. Why should we go back into the past and think about whatever has happened? Once it is forgiven, once we have sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sincere repentance has been done. Now we need to fasten our seat belts and get completely occupied in good things. When do you get time to harp over the past? When you're not preoccupied with something concrete in the present, there are high chances that you would be totally engrossed in what the past is. But what's important, therefore, is to be completely and totally occupied into something so fruitful that keeps you occupied and engaged that you don't think about the past. Point number one. Point number two is we are dealing with a very, very merciful God. We are not dealing with anybody who's, you know, who's so harsh. Auzubillah. We are so blessed that even if we happen to repeat the sin without any, you know, presumptions, inshallah, inshallah, if there is sincere repentance, Allah will forgive us. So why do we call doom and oppression upon ourselves? The fact is that the more you read the Quran, the more you fall in love with Allah because you know how merciful He is. So if there is lack of connection with Allah, the shaitan will make you go back to the thoughts that I am so bad. And that is one of the worst things the shaitan can do, you know. The worst thing is not falling into the pitfall of the sin, but the worst thing is the shaitan telling you over and over again, you are such a loser. You are such a, you know, you are such a sinner. That if the shaitan is doing to you, that is a greater loss than the sin itself. Because then he's winning you over. Right? See, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and hope and fear are the two different wings of a bird. According to Ibn al-Qayyim al-Jawzi, he says that the entire concept of love, fear and hope is like that of a similitude of a bird. The face is the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the two wings are the fear and hope. Now, if you cut off one wing, what will happen? Will the bird be able to fly? No. If you cut off hope and only love, that is, you always only have love of Allah and you say, no, Allah is most forgiving. He's going to forgive me. So it's okay if I sin. I'm a born Muslim. Allah is going to, anyways, all Muslims are forgiven. They're going to go into paradise. That's wrong. We are presuming things. We cannot entitle ourselves like that. And on the other hand, if hope is chopped off and you have only fear, oh my God, Allah is not going to forgive me. I'm such a loser. I'm such a sinner. That's also not right. The bird will only fly if the face is in good condition, if the both wings are in good condition. Similarly, hope and fear have to be balanced. One, if hope is more, it turns to overconfidence and arrogance, which is detrimental. On the other hand, if fear is more, it could lead to despair. That is also detrimental. So we need to have a balance, my dear sister. And for that balance, keep yourself occupied in constantly good things. You know, scholars have said one of the signs of accepted repentance is the fact that see what Allah uses you in. Where are you spending your time, your energies, your efforts? What are the things that you're occupied in and day out? So check yourself. If you're occupied in things which are pleasurable to Allah, Allah is pleased with those things, that means it's good. So keep yourself occupied in fruitful things learning the Quran, teaching the Quran, whatever you're good at, using your skills for the cause of Allah, your talents, your pursuits, your energies, using it for a good cause. That is something which will give you a lot of contentment and take away the ill feeling from your hearts of the sins, the remorse, the regret. See, sisters, there's no guilt feeling in Islam. Understand this concept that there is no guilt feeling in Islam. There is no confession in Islam like you have in some other religions. You stand in front of the priest or the Pope and you confess to your sins. That is nothing like that in Islam, alhamdulillah. All we have to do is cry out our heart to Allah in salah, in sujood, and we pray to Allah to forgive our sins, and Allah is most forgiving. He forgives. So Islam is so beautiful, subhanallah, and it takes away all the grief then. So you got to keep occupied in positive things, and secondly, strengthen your bond with Allah by strengthening your bond with the glorious Quran. The more you read the Quran, the more you'll realize how loving and how merciful Allah is. And the more you'll feel, inshallah, my sins are forgiven. But at the same time, whenever you remember, once in a while, when you think of the sin, immediately you should say, Auzubillah, and seek refuge in Allah and pray that Allah, may I never commit such a sin again. Hope that answers, sister.
Okay, Ustaza, next question. We have a few more, actually. Next question is it permissible to recite the Quran for the dead? This question is from Facebook.
Again, yeah, I wouldn't want to entertain questions related to fiqh. Now, there are so many differences of opinion about that. And, you know, see, this is a book. Al-Quran is a book for the living, my dear sister. Al-Quran is a book for us to attain salvation, for us to seek guidance from there. Unfortunately, we have made it a book to recite upon people who are dead. Now, if that dead person was a sinner, detestable in the sight of Allah, has committed shirk, how in the world do you expect Allah to forgive when he has not forgiven Ibrahim alayhi salam's father, when he has not forgiven Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam's beloved uncle who helped him so much but did not accept shahada? How in the world? I mean, you know, these are things we want to do which seem to be very easy. In fact, Quran is a book which guides the living. It is meant for the living. For the dead, of course, you have so many other things. Whatever good we do, a part of that, it's sadqa-e jariya for our parents, for the dead. So the best part of sadqa-e jariya is we do something good that goes to them. Give charity on behalf of the dead. That will be accepted and the rewards will go to them. Feed the orphans. Be good to the neighbors and ask Allah to reward them. Pray every day. Oh Allah, forgive our dead people. Inshallah, inshallah, they will be forgiven, sisters. But for the technical answer, it's better you go to Islam Q&A and you'll get the complete answer there. ISLAMQA. And they've got 70 different scholars under them. With a proper research, inshallah, inshallah, you should get the most appropriate answer. And I would request, because I'm not qualified to answer the fiqhi questions. There are these authentic websites, so you can visit these websites. And you can ask the other sheikhs, inshallah, who can answer these questions.
Inshallah. Thank you, Ustazah. So just a reminder to everyone, Ustazah will not be answering fiqhi question.
Yeah, and I just wanted to thank all the sisters there on Facebook. I have not been really keeping in touch with them. So lots of love and loads of duas to all the sisters out there across the globe. Allah bless you. And I'm so blessed that you give me time and efforts. May Allah pour barakah into our relationships and may Allah help us to spread the word even more. And I request you all, sisters, to please share all the teachings, what you learn here, and to please share it to as many sisters as possible and to your beloved family as well. Jazakallah.
Okay, the next question is gaming like Xbox allowed for kids as an optional instead of watching TV?
Sorry, could you please repeat it, dear?
Is gaming, video games like mm-hmm. Xbox allowed for children as an option instead of watching TV?
Yeah, that's a big question. And we are strongly of the opinion, myself and Zakir, and I'm sure majority of the speakers today, Islamic speakers across the globe, if you see, are strongly of the opinion that we have to save our generations from these different gadgets and these, you know, iPhones and the iPads and the Xbox. And we have to be really, really very careful when we give them and to what extent we give them. Even if we do, the best would be to avoid all these at least until a particular age. And then if you decide to give them, it has to be strictly and very strictly under parental control. And the parents have to know what the children are watching. In short, we all need to know what we are watching. There was another recent article and a video that I shared from Facebook. If you have seen it on Effective Muslima as well as Tazkiya Ari's group, I shared that, which a couple, both mother and father, they had that entire video done. It was a 7-year or a 9-year old girl who was playing some kind of video game or something, or she was doing her studies or something, and this ad popped up. And when the ad popped up, she was well informed, the little girl was well informed, and therefore she went and she spoke about it to her mother. Her mother and her father, they objected to that, and they played the same thing what the daughter was playing in order to check if it's reoccurring in spite of the complaint that they did. What happened is when the mother and the father played the game in the night, it did not pop up. The next morning, they realized there's something fishy, and therefore the next day, again, in the presence of the parents, they asked her to play the same thing, and can you believe it? It popped up again. Now, what was that? That was a clear-cut advertisement, a short ad of so many things in combination of extramarital relationship, robbing and theft and corruption and illegal sexual relationships, also homosexuals and lesbians. So it was giving alternative genders, and that was so shocking. And finally, this couple declares and they said that, you know, what we did is we covered the camera. The next time we played the same game, we covered it with a camera. We covered the camera with something so that, you know, they don't know who's playing the game. And that time it did not pop up. When the adults were playing, the ad did not pop up, but it is actually aiming at a particular age group from 5 years to 10 to 11 years. It could be anything. Allahu alam, Allah knows what it could be, sisters. But it's a very, very risky affair. It's very dangerous, so to say, you know. So it's an alarming situation, especially parenting is really very challenging in these times. You know, Allah save us and Allah protect us and our generations. So I would, rather say that you have to be very careful when you're giving Xbox games, or if you're giving, you know, although there are so many other games, they say, no, it just has racing and it doesn't have killing. It doesn't have any sexual violence or no, nothing, but there is so much, even in the bike race, when they have the car racing or the bike race, even there they have so much. You have to, when you go across, you know, when you're crossing, you have to cross all the signals, and it's against all the rules. What if the child does the same thing tomorrow when he's actually driving on the streets? And there are so many incidences that have happened. especially this, what is this game that the most popular game, so PUBG. Yeah, PUBG. It's ruining our generations. You know, it. Besides, I'm not even speaking of the other psychological and the emotional factors, how it ruins the mindset of the child, how detrimental it is. I'm not even speaking of that. Just the obvious things, you see. So, hope that answers, sister.
Okay. Hope that answers the question. The next question is, there's a sister, I'll just summarize what she says. She had gone through an abusive relationship with her ex-husband, but she felt like she kept on going through terrible things to herself, such that she got sick and ended up thrice in the hospital. So she would like to get some motivation from yourself.
So you've already, she's not in the relationship anymore, already divorced?
Yes, she already divorced from the ex-husband and she managed to get protection from him, but she kept on going through terrible things. She didn't mention what's the terrible thing is in her short story, but basically she got sick mentally and physically such that she ended up in hospital 3 times.
Subhanallah. Yeah, it takes a lot of courage to have mentioned all this also. May Allah protect you, sister. Alhamdulillah, that at least you are out of the relationship now. So Alhamdulillah for the fact that Allah got you out of that now. Now that you are free. So, you know, maybe you could spend more concrete, positive time with the family that you're in, your parents and whoever you are with now. And the best part is that with all that happened in the past, there may have been so many important learnings for your future life. And we pray that Allah keeps you in His guidance and His care and His protection. And all those who are suffering across the globe. I mean, it's a very sorry state of affairs. There are so many sisters, you know, and we sisters who are with the family, with our husbands, when we are enjoying, we need to remember all these people suffering across the globe and pray for them. Allah protect them and Allah guide them and Allah give them the best. But at least you have to be thankful, sister, and we are all thankful. You are out of it now. You can inshallah work on yourself, build your relationship with Allah, build your relationship with the Quran, do something concrete in your life so that you can look forward to that every morning when you get up. Inshallah, join a class, do something educational if you want to learn a new language so that you are occupied. Learn the language of the Quran, take up a class, inshallah, and be in the company of the righteous people who fear Allah so that they can constantly remind you of Allah and you can remind them of Allah. And read the Quran regularly, inshallah. And of course, I'm sure you're visiting the counselor so that you know you can soon come out of this state of depression that you are in, inshallah. It's all in the hands of Allah, and if your relationship with Allah is strong, it only takes a fraction of a moment, you know, to come out of it, inshallah. It won't take long, inshallah. Allah has got you this far, you'll go even further, inshallah. We all pray for you, sister. Allah bless you and Allah protect you. Ameen.
May Allah ease your issues, sister. We are also praying for you. There's one more question. Last question is, can a brother sever ties with his own real brother if he has committed a grave sin, such as zina?
Allahu Akbar. See, the whole idea is that when a person sins, if a person is sinning anything, any sin that a person has done, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is most forgiving, most merciful, right? We believe in that. And the sin that the person has done, if it has harmed the brother, then it is even more difficult for him to forgive, right? Now, if the person has committed zina, the brother can explain to him and tell him, and if he has sought forgiveness with Allah, if he has truly repented, and if he has resolved not to commit such sins again, inshallah, inshallah, the brother, you know, must forgive him, because he will be indebted to him lifelong if he forgives him. See, because Allah mentions in Surah Nur, chapter number 24, verse number 22, Allah speaks of, you know, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, who used to give financially, who used to support his cousin, his relative by the name Mista, Mista bin Usasa. He was completely taking care of the financial aspect of Mista. And it was Mista who laid an allegation, and he was spreading the rumor at the time of the allegation that was laid, the entire incident of Ufaq, when Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala had lost her necklace, and that whole episode. I cannot go into the details now, but that's the time when the people were laying allegations upon Hazrat Aisha, when they were accusing her of something which she did not do. It was even this cousin of Hazrat Abu Bakr who was adding fuel to fire. Now, upon hearing this, what did Hazrat Abu Bakr do? What was his reaction? He didn't tell anything. He didn't object anything. He didn't take revenge. All what he said was, I'm going to stop my financial assistance to him. Can you imagine your own daughter, which is an honor and a respect, her respect is being shaken, and it is shaken by your own person whom you are feeding. But what is the response of Hazrat Abu Bakr? He says that I'm going to stop the financial aid now. Now, what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say upon this? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals a verse. Allah says, you must forgive, and you must not stop the financial assistance that you are providing. Don't you want Allah to forgive you? And upon this, subhanallah, Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq immediately says, yes, I want Allah to forgive me. And he starts it again. In fact, he increases it also. So that shows that even in spite of the fact that, you know, people are harming your own daughter's izzah, but yet Allah reveals a verse saying that, don't you want Allah to forgive you? Meaning to say, doesn't the brother want Allah to forgive him? If he does, and we all do, we are all at the mercy of Allah, we want Allah to forgive us. Because you know what, sisters, in Islam, the equation is very clear. And the equation is, if I want Allah to forgive me, I have to forgive people. I don't have to forgive you based on the fact that whether or not you deserve to be forgiven. You may or may not deserve to be forgiven, but I forgive you not for your sake, but for my own sake and for the sake of seeking the pleasure and forgiveness of Allah. Because I don't want Allah not to forgive me. If Allah catches hold of me, if Allah does not forgive me, I'm going to be doomed. Therefore, I have to forgive you if I want Allah to forgive me. Right? I have to forgive you because I want Allah to forgive me. I am in need of mercy. You know, many times people say, no, you're not worth being forgiveness. I'm not going to forgive you. You are such and such. So many times I've forgiven you. You don't deserve my forgiveness. Many people say that. But no, what if Allah tells me the same thing? You don't deserve my forgiveness. A'udhu billah, I'm going to be doomed. Because I want Allah to forgive me, I have to be forgiving to people. So hope that answers, sister. And Allah knows best.
Thank you, Saza. There's one more question. I guess this can be the last one.
Yes.
There are many
Maghrib time here, and then we have a couple of announcements.
Yes. There's many negative comments on social media against Islam, some even insulting Allah and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is the best way to deal with this situation?
Yes, subhanallah, that's so true. Recently, that the one that happened at Netherlands and the burning Quran, na'udzubillah, how they have dealt with that. Then in France, the cartoons that they have made, subhanallah, Allah is much more exalted than what they do. And may this unite the believers and make us all even more stronger to stand up against all this that is happening. Tell you a couple of points to do. One is to keep in touch with the people who are, giving us solutions to all this. Most of our shuyukh, they are speaking on the topics that are related to these as and when required. So we must keep in touch with them and what they are answering, and so that we know what's going on, because maybe we are not directly, in connection to these people who are doing all these, who are assaulting Islam and the Muslims. But what we can do is we can at least keep ourselves well-versed with whatever our sheikhs are speaking, whether it's Sheikh Umar Suleiman, Yasir Qadi, Dr. Zakir. Zakir has also been answering these questions in the last couple of weeks, latest his Q&A every Saturday night. So you can keep in touch and you can hear all those answers. But for us, at least, every step that is making the disbelievers hate Islam should make us love Islam all the more. Every step that they are detesting against Islam should make us stronger. And we must talk about it in our families, tell about it to the children. And that should make us even more stronger and get us even more closely connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, my dear sisters. These are tough times we are facing. We need to explain to our children why this is happening, because they are threatened by Islam. The moment, Islam is spreading, and that is poisonous to them. They don't want that to happen. That should make us even more firm in our belief. And that should make us even more stronger, in our preaching as well. And that will spread Islam all the more, inshallah. The more they want to stop it, the more it's going to spread, inshallah. وَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا إِنَّا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَّحِيمٌ. So with that, I think we'll have to stop. There's just one important announcement that I wanted to make, Dina. I'll just okay. do that, and then after that,
yes,
you can carry on with your announcements.
Okay,
so,
go ahead.
So the one special announcement that I wanted to make, sisters, is that, considering all these things that are happening today, that's one thing. Another point is also that some of the sisters have been requesting me for positive parenting and parenting lessons, that if I can do. Whatever parenting programs I have done across the globe, wherever I have, visited, wherever I've gone along with Zakir to in different countries. So I have done a couple of workshops or parenting talks and all that. Based on the experience that I have, inshallah, I am planning to do a couple of programs in the coming Sundays now, inshallah. So, but the only thing is that will not be put up on Facebook. It will only be through Aris on Zoom only. So I'd request sisters who are interested, of course, mothers, would-be mothers, already mothers, for their grandchildren. So it could qualify anyone and everyone who's interested in positive parenting, parenting with purpose, conscious parenting. So it would be about all that with a lot of Quranic Islamic approach to that, inshallah. And we will have an interactive session also in the midst of that, a couple of exercises. And that's why it's not going to be possible online on Facebook, but it's going to be possible only on Zoom. So I'd request you, whoever is interested, to enroll for this. There'll be registration, and only those who are registered, because I don't want to have everyone. We rather have a selected few who are interested in it so that they can benefit, inshallah, with it, inshallah. So looking forward to have you all, sisters. Actually, in the last couple of sessions, it has been such a rush, that we've just been... There was no time for interaction also. So this would be lessons, not really workshops that I can call, because whatever I have done in the past were workshops, but they were all on-site web workshops. Now, since this is going to be an online thing, I won't call it a workshop because it will not be possible to make it that interactive. But whatever best I can, inshallah, I'll try to put it up and we can have that, inshallah. But it will be only for those who have registered and genuinely interested sisters can be a part of it. So that it has a lot of barakah and so that it's beneficial, inshallah. So, and there's no age limit as such. Even young girls who are looking forward to being mothers, already mothers and grandmothers can also be there, inshallah. So it's all up to you who's interested, inshallah. So yeah, that's it, inshallah. We'll have it posted through Aris.
Inshallah.
Over to you, Tisha. Jazakallahu khairan kaseeran, sisters. Lots of love, loads of duas. Hoping to have you back soon. And then we'll resume back our Dar series, our Quran series, because our pondering over the Quran is indeed a very, very important affair. We have to get our family and our loved ones connected to the glorious Quran. Meanwhile, keep connected and do remind your brothers and sisters, your children and your family and your parents about, tafsir of the Quran and reading the Quran and being attached to the glorious Quran, inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan.
Inshallah, Aris will have the announcement and the link to register. At the moment, there's no link to register for the course, the parenting course that Ustazah mentioned. Inshallah, we will post it. So keep checking out our social media on Instagram and Facebook. The details you can see in the poster that I give is actually the same contact info. So you can also contact our admin for more information. So,
and I'll also, once it's ready, I'll also post it on Effective Muslima and other groups, inshallah, sister.
Inshallah. So the two courses that are coming up for Aris are the special tafsir course by Sheikh Dr. Samarjab. This will be on-site course. Inshallah, it will be the last course that the last tafsir course that will be run from KL. So those who are in KL, please take this opportunity. It's an extremely useful course. And the next one is the Beautiful Names of Allah, taught by Sheikh Dr. Shu'aib. This will also start in October. And it, inshallah, will be online, so everyone from everywhere around the world can join and register. Okay, so that's all the announcement for today. Inshallah, we will resume our session next week. May Allah give us the greatest privilege to see the face of Allah in Jannah. Please spare some time to do the sujood at-tilawah right after this, inshallah. With this, I end our session today. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta nastaghfiruka wa atubu ilaik. Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.